We're doing a new thing today. There's a camera back there. And the camera, assuming everything works right, will be uploading our sermons and special music sorts of things to YouTube. So, new year, new thing. We'll see how this works. There is a spiritual practice called Lectio Divina. That's a Latin phrase meaning divine reading. In that practice, a person reads a passage of scripture, often aloud, listening with his mind's ear, very carefully, to hear what it's saying to him, what word or phrase leaps out or seems to have particular meaning on that particular day. He then spends a period of time meditating on that word or phrase. Now, this works really well in a group setting in which each person takes turns reading that particular passage of scripture that someone has chosen, preferably using different translations. And then each person meditates for a few moments and shares as a prayer where that reading took them. It is actually quite a nice thing to do in a group. Perhaps we'll try it sometime. When I first read this passage, for example, it was as if verse 17 was written in big neon letters. Every good gift, every perfect gift comes from above. This seems so fitting for the second Sunday after Christmas that I quickly named the sermon, "The Gifts Keep Coming." Then I reminded our music folks that it is still Christmas, and we can keep singing Christmas music for at least one more week. Thank you. Naturally, the gifts I was thinking about weren't the kind that come in packages that got maybe delayed in the mail or that somebody showed up with late from somewhere else, but rather the gifts that we think about most during the Christmas season: peace, love, hope, joy. I thought about the gifts that a new year brings with the possibilities of new starts and new challenges. Deanne and I chose to use Isaiah 43 verse 19 for the scripture reading on the masthead of the collar from the Message version, Jennifer. It says, "I'm about to do something brand new. It's bursting out. Don't you see it?" For me, as you all know, this year is new in almost every way. And if you don't know, please read your collar because I wrote my Reverend Minion article all about that. And if you don't have a collar, it's posted on the First Christian Church Soma website. For your reading pleasure. As the week between Christmas and the New Year progressed, I began to witness gifts that I hadn't really thought about much. The gift of friendship manifested in the lives of people who had suffered a loss. The gift of connected family could be seen in the emails flying between folks who had loved ones in the hospital. The gift of creativity showed up as ideas blossomed around the 100th anniversary of our building. The gift of selfless service is all around me. Five different people showed up in the office this week to see if there was any way they could help Deanne get the newsletter out. The phrase, "how can I help," is something I hear a lot about that around here, and that is a tremendous gift. And I've got to tell you, I have never heard so many good prayers as there are in this congregation. It is a tremendous gift. Then this morning, as I read the passage one more time, I saw the phrase, "we are like the first crop in a harvest that God has created." And I wondered what exactly that meant. Usually when we think of giving our first fruits, we think of giving the very best that we have to offer. The Hebrew Bible is full of descriptions of exactly what is acceptable as a sacrificial gift to God. Rams and bulls and doves that are completely, perfectly without blemish. The finest pressing of olives and grapes. The loveliest cloth from a loom. The whitest flower. We think of giving to God what is best and most lovely, things that are perfect, the perfect fruit from a tree, the best part of our harvest from the garden in our backyard. And yet this passage says the first crop of the harvest. Now, I grew up on a farm, so I know a little bit about first crops. And the fact of the matter is that the first crop from an apple tree or a grapevine, or the first eggs from a hen, or the wheat that's harvested from that firstly planted furrow, the first year's crop of asparagus, none of them are the best. It takes asparagus 7 years to get good. The first pot that a potter throws, the first shirt a new tailor sews, the first meal anybody cooks. Again, not our best efforts. We might try really hard, but it's not going to be great. It's not what we usually think about when we think about our gifts to God. When I was simplifying my life a couple of years ago, I had two piles of stuff. I had one pile that was stuff that I was definitely keeping because I really, really loved it or really, really needed it. Not a great fan of colanders, but I know I have to have one because I am a great fan of pasta. The other was stuff that I simply had and either didn't like or didn't need or no longer had a use for, or somebody gave me and I felt like I couldn't get rid of it. None of you have gifts like that, right? My mantra was that if it didn't enhance my life, it was out of here. Most of the sorting went very easily. But there were a couple of really tough decisions, things I kept moving from one pile to the other. One was the ugliest pottery ashtray known to humanity. It was made by a stepson when he was in the fifth grade, decades ago, and it was supposed to be an owl. Had little owl ears and everything. I ended up keeping it because I could not look at it and not remember the look on his face when he gave it to me, because you see, he had always made all those kinds of gifts for his real mother. And this was the first thing he made for me. This first attempt at pottery, ugly and misshapen as it was the first evidence that he was growing to care for me. And so I kept it. So perhaps the gifts that God wants from us are not the gifts of the best we have to offer after all. And that thought brought me back to the beginning of the passage, the part I wasn't going to preach on today. No one who is tested should say, God is tempting me. That's because God is not tempted by any form of evil, nor does God tempt anyone. Everyone is tempted by their own cravings. They are lured away and enticed by them. Once those cravings conceive, they give birth to sin, and when sin grows up, it gives birth to death. See, I was going to preach just about gifts today. I mean, I understood why the bit about every good gift comes from God follows the part about how temptation does not come from God. And please notice that we are also not directed to blame the devil for things that go wrong either. According to James, we have no one to blame but ourselves. Thank you very much. And then I thought about how the change from giving into temptation to serving God is the path that we follow. It is the way in which we are the first harvest. Consider. James is writing primarily to Gentiles, people who had not known much about the God of the Hebrew people or the law. He was writing to people who hadn't grown up with the law. They were accustomed to worshiping gods whose behavior was very often a prime example of the way people should not behave. You know, raping young women, turning people into ugly monsters because they're jealous, killing people who oppose them, and so on. The Greek and Roman gods and the Egyptian ones also were not necessarily moral examples. James was teaching these people how to live as Christians. That included taking responsibility for their own actions. Instead of blaming your misdeeds on some outside force, something that you could not resist, he said, you need to understand that you're tempted by your own cravings, and those cravings can lead you into sin, and those sin leads to death of the spirit. Flip Wilson was a very popular comedian in the 60s and 70s. One of the best known comedic characters that he invented was Geraldine, a sassy black woman whose boyfriend was named Killer, and whose catchphrase was, "The devil made me do it." In 1970, Wilson won his first Grammy for an album titled, "The Devil Made Me Buy That Dress." Geraldine became so popular that when anybody did anything wrong, they said, "The devil made me do it." Another of Flip Wilson's well-known characters, the Reverend Leroy of the Church of What's Happening Now, would no doubt have promised Geraldine complete forgiveness and salvation for one of those perfect sacrificial gifts, like a Cadillac or a jet plane. But I suspect that those aren't the gifts that God desires from us. I suspect that God prefers our first fruits to our best ones. I believe that God would be much happier with an ugly owl ashtray than with the most perfect, beautifully crafted ceramic owl known to the art world. These things that tempt us, these cravings that can lead us into sin, those, I think, would be the gifts that God prefers. I hate to keep harping on the way we behave on freeways. But I think we all sort of relate to how people behave on freeways. If we give in to our anger and frustration there in the safety of that iron cage where no one can hear us vent and call the other driver, whatever we call him, the time may come when we give into it at a much less appropriate occasion. And that could cause us to damage another person, perhaps physically, but more likely emotionally. And hurting another person is a sin. I don't mean we should hold in the anger or pretend never to get angry, as that can cause significant emotional and psychological damage, which we don't want to do. I mean letting the anger go. In this situation, simply allowing the idiot in the other car to be the idiot in the other car. And perhaps pray that he is not killed by his own idiocy. At first. But I think God would be greatly pleased at the attempt. And eventually, you know, you practice something long enough, you will get good at it. Well, most people will. I still never be able to read music, and I've just given up on it. But anger is an easy example because most of us know what that is. We mostly get angry from time to time. But each of us has our own cravings, our own character traits that can lead us into sin, into causing harm to ourselves or to somebody else. We each know our own temptations and where they can lead us. These are things that we can work at changing within ourselves, offering the work of change to God as our gift, knowing that our first efforts are gifts of great value. The gifts just keep coming. They do. We receive the gift of life from the Lord our God, and in return we give God our lives. What a great exchange. The good news is that God does not require perfection from us. God doesn't ever turn away a gift because it's not good enough. Rather, God accepts all the gifts that we offer with joy. God's love for each of us is unconditional and eternal. God loves each one of us exactly the way we are, asking only that we return that love to the best of our ability. And every day that best is a little different. When we go from this place today, let us go with gladness, giving to others the same gifts which we have received, that love and peace and hope and joy of the season. And may these gifts be offered always in the name of Jesus the Christ, the Son of God, from whom all good gifts come. If you are not yet part of the body of Christ and wish to become a member of that body through baptism, or if you're looking for a church home and want to become part of that family here at First Christian, or if you simply wish to take this occasion to recommit yourself to life in Christ, you're invited to come forward during the singing of our hymn of commitment, As with Gladness.